please tell me who you are and why you're here.
Hi, I'm Menno Day. I'm a PhD candidate at Fontys University of Applied Sciences and the University of Eindhoven. And I'm here to present the games we developed during the Swim Games, Games for Health Jam this year. So we developed games for in the swimming pool. And I'm here to present a game from a dev camp, which we won. So that was really cool.
So you're here to present a lot of games.
Yeah, actually we do. Yeah, we have a post session somewhere over there on the Six Packs project. I was part of that too.
Yeah.
So there's a lot going on. Mm.
Tell me a bit about the swim games. What are they about?
Well, there's the swimming center in Eindhoven, the Tongerep. They came to us and said, like, we have a huge decline in visitors lately. And we're not sure what to do with it, and we'd like to make our swimming pool a little bit more attractive to today's youth. And they did, like, loads of innovation back in the 70s. And after that, it actually stopped. They didn't innovate anymore. So they asked us to come up with some innovative and interactive products for their swimming pool. Also, we wanted to, we were researching ways to get people and children physically active. Mm-hmm. And this was one way to engage them in physically in physical activities.
Yeah. And what does the game do?
Well, actually, we try to invite people to play instead of forcing them to do specific
activities. So you hang around in the swimming pool and you said, come and play our game, or how did it work?
No, yeah, it's more it's more that you give a sort of environment in which people can play. And moving as physically active is an integral part of the gameplay. And the way we'd like to elicit and invite people to this kinds of play is by, actually, I don't know. That's a really good question. The thing is that we try to make games that are really easy to step in and easy to step out. So there's no winning scenario. You can play it with one person or with loads of people at the same time. Mm-hmm. And we're still searching for ways how to implement them in the swimming pool. Because now we did it with, we invited children over to the swimming pool to play them. The main reason for it is that there will be a standard or a physical console in the swimming pool in which people can play. So that's always there, right?
Uh-huh. Yeah, yeah. Why is it interesting for you to to be active in the field of serious games? Why? Because if I were a game builder, I think I would probably love to build a shooter or something like that.
But oh yeah, well,
not a serious
honestly,
game.
Honestly, the serious game is really, really is a really cool place to work. I think that in the serious games environment, you're always forced to research and to come up with new ways to play, because you always have to. There's also some innovation. Like, I can do a shooter, and a shooter can. There's loads of innovations in shooters, of course. But normally a client comes to you and says, we have this and this problem, can we make a game from it? And you always have to use the issues that they come forward with as an integral part of the gameplay. So you always have a sort of innovative game to create. Mm-hmm. And I think that's the most exciting part of it.
Yeah.
Also that you work with lots of different partners. So I remember that we're working for innovation platform of a company that make cucumbers. And then you're working with people about safe sex, right? So you have like loads of different aspects you can work with. And I think it's a really, really diverse field to be in.
Yeah, so yeah. That's really challenging. You're challenged all the time to, well, think about different ways in and different ways to.
Yeah, and I think it really results in new ways of play, and I think that's really, really cool and important as well.
Yeah, yeah. One of the things that's being said is that in the serious games are sometimes too serious, and they don't have enough. Of the game mechanics in them. So, mm-hmm. so that you are want to play them again and again and
yeah,
again.
Fair enough. I think that's mainly because game developers, when they start creating a game, they start with designing rules and regulations for the game. So immediately they start in impairing the player's movement and the player's creativity, which makes it really difficult for people to make their own game. And what my research is about is how can we come up with games that are within this restricted environment of the client or education for this matter, and how you can actually do something of yourself, do something autonomous within this game. And most games are about just show you what you should do, and when you're doing it right, you're getting points, and when you're doing it wrong, you're getting punished, right?
Yeah.
So I think that's the wrong way to approach gaming, actually. I think we already do that in loads of other environments, and I think it's better to give people a bit of freedom in their game. And I think games are the medium to accomplish that.
Mm. Do you feel that the serious gaming industry is maturing?
Yes.
Yeah.
Gladly. Yeah. Sure. Yeah. Definitely.
Because I was here last year as well, compared to last year, there seem to be a lot of universities involved at this time.
Yeah, that's a good thing. I think that's a really, that's true, yeah. I think that there's a lot of research being done, but also companies are finding their ways how to differentiate themselves for the competitors, and there's a lot of maturity going on. I worked as a researcher at Run Series Games for 1.5 years, and then I started my PhD project, and I always come back to the company and see what they're doing, and it's always going up, always better.
Really?
Yeah.
So does that mean the environment, Holland, maybe the rest of the world are taking it more seriously than they used to, or do they still have to struggle to get the?
Well, you still have to struggle.
Yeah.
Because the my game was on mathematics. I did a game on mathematics for secondary school students. As I said, my games are about feeling autonomous and an autonomy supportive environment, and that doesn't always fit with the didactics of a school. Still, we made a game that really fitted the curriculum. We used the coursebook as an example for the level structure in it and stuff. So it was really well done. We had domain experts looking at the game, saying it worked and it was it was fine and educational. And then you try to come up with your validation research, and you call up to schools, ask them whether or not you can have a group of students for 1 hour, you know?
Yeah, so that they can play, so you can have your data and to validate the game, yeah.
Here we go. That was like almost impossible to accomplish. I think I phoned and called like 150 schools in the Netherlands, and I used my network and my friends and everyone, and most of them didn't see the potential, it was too much work for them, and they didn't see how it fitted their learning space. This, I think still there's a lot of work to be done.
Yeah. A lot of terrain to be...
Yeah. And I think it starts at universities. I think the reason that there are so many universities involved in game research and game making is a really good start for the companies, because those are the people of the future, right? And they sort of know how they can use games and how they can't use games. And I think that's a really, really good start.
Starting point, yeah. Are there any other major subjects when you look at serious games that you think are important today? So
today.
You have the validation. Mm-hmm. Well, not today, but now.
Now.
Yeah. You have validation. That's an important thing.
Yeah.
Money.
I don't really understand the question. Sorry.
No, I think it wasn't clear enough. Are there any other main trends when you look at serious games? Are there things you think that need to be tackled?
I think indeed validation is one, but I think lots of companies work for that. Especially MyCognition did a great talk about the validation of their game.
Yeah.
That's it's good for our industry, of course. And in my research, I witnessed a change in motivation towards learning for the better. So that's good too. And I think motivation is one really important aspect of using games. And I think if we really want to use games at their best, we should really look forward to offering people new ways to approach an issue. Because what we normally do is sort of standardize, like digitize normal exercises. And with games, they're interactive. You can play in many ways. You can play in your own style. And you can come up with your own solution to a problem. And I think boosting someone's creativity through a game would be a really, really well point of departure for the new upcoming games, actually.
Mm-hmm.
So I think we should open up the serious games, loosen up a bit about what we really want to accomplish, and see if people themselves can come up with solutions to an issue instead of giving them the issue.
And pushing them through a tunnel. So
yeah.
You say, here it is, just take it and
I think it's sort
see
of,
what you can do
yeah,
with
I
it.
I think it sort of suits with problem-based education. I think if we use problem-based educational concepts in our today's game design, we come up with far more interesting games than we already have.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Yeah.